I use the term affect in my title. By affect, I mean humanly held and historically generated sentiments which become actionable, which may become a spur to action. Distinct from that, armed affect is a further development when these sentiments become actionable to the point of killings, maimings, and exclusions. The next thing to define is, what is Jerusalem? Briefly, the city stands at the centre of the medieval Christian worldview. It is the heart and core of an imaginary that through the centuries has grown to a fullness in the minds of Christians, Jews, and Muslims alike. For Christians, it is the place of Christ's torment, death, and supposed resurrection. For Jews, the historic location of the first and second temples, destroyed by the Babylonians and the Romans respectively. For Muslims, the place of the Prophet Muhammad's supposed celestial ascent, the Miraj. Jerusalem is the pivotal point of an arc of nostalgia and desiring, perennially reenacted by successive generations through the ages up to our present time. During its history since the 4th century BC, the city has been destroyed at least twice, besieged 23 times, captured and recaptured 44 times, and attacked 52 times. It is a propagator of affect, and equally of armed affect, that has then justified a train of possessions, dispossessions, and repossessions through the centuries. There are, however, alternative voices who make the journey to Jerusalem. They are the faithful who make no claim to arms and no claim to possession or dispossession. For instance, Yehuda Halevi, the great Jewish poet of Al-Andalus, who left his native Andalus in 1140, setting sail for Jerusalem. His hyper-realistic sea song sets the tone. Faint-hearted, quaking in my boots, God, I gasp out and break into a cold sweat. The oarsmen gape at the deep. The helmsman lurches towards the wheel. A sorry sight, holding on to the rail, I'm dangling between sea and sky. I reel and stagger, all trifles, if only to dance down your streets, Jerusalem. For his part, the Muslim sage Ibn al-Arabi, who also left from Andalus and travelled to Jerusalem, prefers to express the essential unity of Christians, Jews and Muslims, a direct counter to assumptions of interfaith war and against othering. He says, "There was a time when I would reject those who were not of my faith, but now my heart has grown capable of taking on all forms. It is a pasture for gazelles, an abbey for monks, a table for the Torah, Kaaba for the pilgrim. My religion is love. Whichever the route love's caravan shall take, that shall be the path of my faith." Jerusalem is also a generating factor in musical production. The continuous mobilizations for war against Islam gave rise to songs, crusader songs. The category of crusader songs is necessarily broad. Although in many cases datings are difficult, they number over 100 over a period of about 100 years from 1188 to 1270. Taken together, they are a powerful musical and lyrical expression of armed affect. Now, into this particular historical cockpit step two figures who are the subject of this paper: the German poet Walter von der Vogelweide and the Emperor Frederick II, King of Sicily and Holy Roman Empire, or more precisely, his court. Walter von der Vogelweide, shown in my opening image, was a German poet in the Minnesänger tradition. Courtly love songs, Minne, post-1150, in which he is regarded as preeminent in terms of his both output and legacy. He was peripatetic, in the sense of moving between various courts according to the availability of patronage, and also in the sense of his political allegiances. At some point in his career, Walter wrote what has come to be known as his Palestina Lied, Song of Palestine. In it, the poet imagines himself to be walking in the Holy Land, a land of Christian miracles, although it is not clear whether he actually ever went to Palestine. The land, he says, is claimed by the three faiths, but, as he says, we are pursuing a just claim, and it is right that God should grant it. Recht ist, dass uns gewähr. The poem opens with an evocation of the nobility of the land of Palestine where Christ walked, where the virgin birth took place, and where Christ was tormented and crucified. A place of miracles. In this land, Christ rose again. The land is pronounced as holy and is recognized by God as such. In it, there will be a day of judgment. Christians, Jews, and undifferentiated heathens, in other words, Muslims, all claim this place. But the Christian claim is just, so God should grant it. Palestine, with Jerusalem at its core, is a place of miracles. And miracles and the trading of miracles were a power resource for church and rulers alike, as witnessed in the collection and exploitation of saints' reliquaries, the big business of pilgrimages, the exploitation of that affect. Poetry and song were a part of that mobilisation, and as war propaganda, the Palestina Lied stands as part of the transactional process of that imaginary. Consideration of the musical aspect of the Palestina Lied now takes us into interesting areas as regards the representation of power at the micro level, specifically in music and song. Only a small number of Minnelied melodies have survived to the present day, mainly in manuscripts that date from the 15th century or later, which may possibly present the songs in a form other than the original form. We are fortunate that the Palestina Lied comes with music attached. While it is more or less possible to read pitch values from the notations contained in the manuscript tradition, there are large difficulties in establishing questions of rhythm and pace. The following is the available notation for the song, and also a recorded version of the song in reconstruction. Lebe ich viel werde, sieht mein sündig Leugel sie. Das leere Land von euch die Erde, dem man so viel berechtigt. Nicht geschehen, dass ich ihr bat, ich bin kommen an die Stadt. In the study of medieval song, questions of originality and influence have long been of interest to researchers. Were songs original creations, or were they copies of other songs? There has been much discussion of the processes of contrafact, or the circulation, copying, and reuse of melodies of songs. Heinrich Hussmann in 1953, and later Friedrich Genrich, claimed that the Palestina Lied was a direct contrafact of Geoffrey Rudel's L'Encan Ligurne, as two of the most famous medieval melodies, and this claim, you still find it reproduced in the research literature. However, in a 1982 article, James McMahon showed that the song is not a contrafact, but simply uses a great many melodic motifs that can be considered the common property of medieval composers. In other words, the use and reuse of elements that are formulaic. He cites the stress on the notes D, F, D, the rise to the fifth, E, G, A, the rise to the upper third, A, C, A, in the middle of the melody, and the gradual return down to a cadence on D. Moving from the macro power ambit of wars and crusades, we can now consider issues of micro power in song relations, and that takes us inevitably to the question of patronage as an area of micro power. It was a condition of many poets of the medieval era to be constantly in movement, sometimes for reasons of persecution and exile, Dante among them, sometimes for economic reasons, the quest for a livelihood. Making a living as a poet often meant having to engage with a patron. Patronage generally entailed the writing of poetry that praised that patron. But this is a power relationship which is bilateral and which has dependency on both sides. The poets know that they have the advantage of some form of immortality. Through text distribution, contrafact, manuscript and print, their words have a durability through time. Poets have power. Writing of Walter von der Vogelweide, Hatter speaks of a poem in which Walter courts Frederick's favour, that's Frederick II, courts Frederick's favour to a melody which he was still using in Frederick's interest many years later. In praise of his new patron, Walter will have invented a suitable strophe and melody. But if the patron proves disappointing, Walter would continue to use the same tune, but the words would begin to go off. This type of song was termed a twinklied or dunning song. Within the limits of personal safety, the negative might even be taken to the point of lampooning, and this negativity was certainly exercised in relation to the Emperor Otto. As we shall see, the questions of sociology of the court are important as regards poetic production. Incidentally, the Emperor Frederick eventually gave Walter a fief, a small donation, whether of a house or land or a pension is unclear, as was celebrated in Walter's famous König Friedrichston. Ich han min Lehnen, all die Welt, ich han min Lehnen. I have my fief, all the world, I have my fief. As regards the Palestina lead, I would end with a brief observation regarding its structure. The lines are heptasyllabic. The rhyme scheme is AB, AB, CCC. The musical structure is AAB. What is striking is that the poem falls comfortably into the versified canso forms that were characteristic of the troubadour tensone, tenso, in Provence, in which countervailing positions are argued in verse between two or more protagonists. For instance, we can look at the rhyming structure of this tenso, which was recorded in Harvey and Patterson's work. The rhyme scheme here can be rendered as AB, AB, CCB, or if you want to simplify it down, as AA, BBBA. Now, aside from the final exit line, this matches the rhyme scheme of Walter's poem, which we can see as follows. Here, the rhyme scheme is again A, B, A, B, C, C, C. Walter's poem also ends with a characteristic troubadour envoi addressed to an unnamed lady. And in the classic manner of the tenso, the poet offers his work for another's judgment of its merits, another reason why the song can be seen within the operational ambit of the tenso tradition. Since that is also the operational framework of the Italian sonnet form, this makes the Palestina lead and the sonnet very close neighbours, not least because they coexisted within the court of Frederick II. So now let us take our next step and turn to look at the sonnet. The Palestina lead has been dated to the time of the Fifth Crusade, 1217 to 1221. The emergence of the sonnet is coterminous with the Fifth and Sixth Crusade a few years later, 1228 to 1229. Therefore, the Palestina lead and the sonnet fall within a single time frame. The poets are part of a courtly retinue, the court of the Emperor Frederick II, that is engaged in war against the Arab and Muslim other. Now, the figure of Frederick is a contested one. I won't say much about him, but he headed up the Sixth Crusade, 1228 to 1229, but he also had an abiding interest in Arabo-Islamic ideas and culture, as was well addressed in a 1958 article by Francesco Gabrieli. And on the 17th of March, 1229, Frederick proclaimed his lordship over the Kingdom of Jerusalem. Now, for the moment, we are more interested in the cultural life of his court. The Sicilian court of the Emperor Frederick II was the epicentre of a very particular cultural production. In the literary field, poetry, in the threefold form of the canzone and the ballata, but also of the sonnet. More than as a poetic form, the sonnet has to be understood as a social institution. It involved courteous interchanges between gentlemen, each deferring to the knowledge of the other and inquiring of their opinions, just in the manner of the Provençal poets who debated various topoi or commonplaces in their tenso exchanges. Now, the dating of this activity in the Sicilian court is roughly 1220 to 1240. In early examples of the sonnet, there is a high-minded tone to this method of inquiry. For instance, in Sonnet 19 of Giacomo da Lentini, in correspondence with Jacopo Mostacci, he says, sollecitando un poco meo savere, working a bit on my knowledge, I have a bit of a doubt and I would like to turn to you and ask your opinion. I really want your opinion on this matter. I'm eager to hear from you, and that's why I request your judgment. Now, as regards the themes that were engaged in this poetic activity, the research literature customarily addresses sonnet culture as a discourse of love, courtly love, etc. However, arguably, it is actually more a manifestation of scientific interest, of debate and of inquiry regarding natural phenomena. However, as I say, the primordial fact of the sonnet as genre is that it begins life as social interchange, as above, social capital, if you like. The poets of the so-called Sicilian school, La Scuola Siciliana, are more or less 24 in number. Those associated with the court were Giacomo da Lentini, the notary and reputed originator of the sonnet, Frederick himself, his son, King Enzo, his secretary, Pierre delle Vigne, the judge, Guido delle Colonne, a family friend, Stefano Protonotaro, Jacopo Mostacci, who was Federico's falconer, Percivale Doria, his vicar general on the mainland, Odo delle Colonne, his ambassador to Egypt, as well as others whose biographies cannot be precisely fixed. They all engaged in this writing of sonnets, and those sonnets were often written as part of a poetic correspondence between peers. They instance technical virtuosity, the management of difficult rhyme schemes and so on, and peer deference of varying degrees. So as a consolidated block of cultural production, the sonnet can be seen as a dispositif, as the pivotal point of a set of socio-cultural transactional practices that shape modalities of power. And I suggest that the sonnet as a historical genre cannot be adequately understood outside of this framework. Furthermore, and critically, it cannot be understood adequately without the realization that the practice of competitive or emulative poeteering also manifested itself in other courtly circles in Europe. Here we can cite the pattern of poetic sittings. Sittings is a good Arabic word, actually, for this. Poetic sittings at kingly courts around Europe. There's the court of Frederick in Sicily, Alfonso X in Castile, a prolific poet and compiler of the famous Cantigas de Santa Maria, Denis I of Portugal, known as the Poet King, with his collection of Cantigas de Amigo. Interesting, each of these locations has a Hohenstaufen lineage, so we can identify it as a historically generalized phenomenon. The phenomenon also reproduced itself in the so-called puis of northern France, notably that of Arras, where the attendees also included English royalty. Marian in inspiration, these poetic guilds were places where poetry was recited in a spirit of competition, and crowns were awarded for the prince of the proceedings. The time is actually long overdue for a reasoned historical and sociological analysis of the operations of this power phenomenon. So now to conclude, in this paper, in line with the theme of our conference, I have attempted to deal with an interlocking complex of power and influence pivoted on the power of song in the context of the Mediterranean. I close now with three points. The Palestina lead has a structure that is curiously similar to that of the sonnet. If you double its ABABCCC structure, you get the rhyme scheme of the sonnet. ABAB, ABAB, CCC, CCC. And the question is, what are we to make of this? Also, the Palestina lead comes into Frederick's court with music attached, as we have seen. And it is historically contiguous with the sonnet. So perhaps it is time to reassess Aurelio Roncalia's assumption, long asserted and still current, that the sonnet categorically had no music. Furthermore, and finally, if the Palestina lead predates or is concurrent with the emergence of the sonnet, as appears to be the case, could it have actually been part of the original modelling process of the sonnet, whose origins are still something of a mystery? So, for the moment, that is all I have to say, except that there is much work still to be done, and that this is a shortened version of a longer paper which I am happy to share. Thank you for your attention, and a very special thank you to the organising team for our conference. I look forward to the next time when we can all meet in the flesh. Thank you.